Hello everybody, thanks so much for joining us again. I'm not going to laugh. I'm so pleased this afternoon to be joined by my friend and other autism mum, Jo Abbey. We're starting this so professionally because there's been the dog squeaky toy in the background, teenagers talking.
Children coughing and screaming.
The production values on this are exceptional. We're no different today. So welcome Jo, who, as I said, is an autism mum and journalist and just a genuine supporter of autism awareness. So thank you for joining us, Jo.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I'm so pleased to be included.
Well, I suspect you have got one of those family stories that everyone's going to really feel for at the moment, because you are working from home, you are juggling three kids on your own and a full-time job. How is all of that going?
Surprisingly easy on my end. This is sort of the life that me and the boys always live. If they never had to leave the house again, they would be stoked. The biggest challenge has been my daughter, who's used to leaving the house. But I sort of have been feeling like, welcome to our world. So my eldest, who has autism and mental illness, does distance education. And then my younger son with autism just has a lot of trouble going to school. So it has sort of been a gift for us, just that people understand that health doesn't always mean leaving your house regularly and that education can be effective from home.
So do you think in some ways families are getting a bit of a sneak peek of what might work for some kids who just learn differently and whose school really is challenging?
That's my hope, because I always feel like, and have since the start of this autism experience, it started in 2005 for me when we got the first diagnosis, although I'd known for years that he had autism. I think that what I want to get out of this is that we stop trying to have all children do the same things in the same way, particularly when it comes to education. So some kids learn really well in a classroom setting. Some learn really well from home. Some learn with a combination of both. Some need to be guided, some don't. So let's look at the child and see what works best for them when it comes to education and lifestyle, and then meet them halfway.
Yeah, it seems really simple, but it's funny that something like COVID had to happen for us to all of a sudden realise that that's kind of okay.
Well, I'm worried it's going to go back to the way it was before. And I've always felt guilty that my eldest was homeschooled and felt bad that he didn't leave the house very often. And all that guilt has disappeared during lockdown. And I'm sad that it had to happen in this way. And I'm worried that it's going to go back to the way it was when this is all over. So I think the next fight is going to be, for me, just trying to keep up those different options for different children, because my boys are like night and day. Their needs are so different, even though they both have autism. They function so differently.
Yes, and I was going to ask what would be helpful, but I think what you're saying is if we could use the kind of flexibility we've had over the last 6 weeks going forward for our kids with autism, so we can just decide, you know, because there's no one size fits all for our kids. We have to really look at them and see what their needs are and what the needs are of our family. And often education systems aren't great at fitting in with that.
They're not great at all. And even the way they've rolled out school from home for neurotypical families, they've literally just tried to run a class at home with consistent hours and busy work that is completely unnecessary to learning. Like, they should have had a crisis plan where it's just core subjects you can't catch up on, like maths and one other subject. You know, don't have my daughter cutting out shapes out of coloured paper, you know, and sticking them on something just for busy work. And so I'm hoping next time the curriculum is really, you know, down to that core. So when we're in lockdown, parents have time to work, but also we can just, you know, keep up that stuff that you can't catch up on later, like mathematics and maybe just reading and things like that.
But there are, I mean, you're quite right, and I suspect education departments all around the country are going to scramble to make sure that they're ready if this happens.
Oh yeah, they'll be right on top of it, Nicole. They're going to change it really, really quickly and roll it out for us because they're incredibly effective like that.
Sure. Wow.
In 17 years' time, they might go, maybe we'll streamline it next time.
I was just saying, there's some really good resources already, not just mathematics, but things like the Khan Academy and remember old-fashioned books. There are still good things that kids can be doing and maybe not cutting out coloured shapes.
But they don't have time to do the self-learning and the self-exploration because they're so busy with the curriculum that has been set to them. What I've loved about my boys having a more streamlined education, just because they have refused to participate in traditional education, is they've got time to just, you know, follow their curiosity and access programs that are meaningful to them and do online art courses. But what I found with my daughter having to do the full load from home, she had no time to do any of that because she was so busy with the work that school had assigned her. So it'd be great if they had some breathing space in education and say to kids, what do you want to learn more about? They don't actually do that at all in school. That it's university when they start to do that.
Yeah, and we've got to get our kids through that, and that's quite a few years before we do.
Yes.
You touched on earlier, you know, for a lot of kids with autism, particularly a lot of older kids, we start bumping into some mental health issues, and for parents as well. Like, we're all dealing with the same kind of thing. What's your advice to parents who have got kids who are having mental health issues or severely increased anxiety? How do we separate those two things out, the autism from the mental health? It's really difficult to do and hard for you when the pressure's on you as the parent, being the sole person helping out.
Look, you can't separate it. That's just the thing. I don't think any kid just has autism. It's always with, you know, a sprinkle of this and a touch of that. And sometimes the sprinkle of this and touch of that is even worse than the actual autism. I mean, autism is just a different way of thinking, as, you know, all autism parents know. It's actually quite a brilliant way to think, and it's a gift. But, you know, couple that with anxiety and couple that with pressure to act normal and couple that with, you know, the severe mental health issues I've seen in my eldest, which led to several suicide attempts. And you start to realize that each child is a different little puzzle, and you just have to sort of figure out what that puzzle entails and then cater to that. So I don't separate it at all. So my eldest boy has autism, anxiety, and a generalized mood disorder, which means he'll be quite up and then, you know, very depressed. And then my younger son has autism and anxiety, and also I keep forgetting what it's called, where you scramble the order of things. It's just flown out of my head because I've only had two instead of six. What's that?
Auditory processing?
Yeah, something like that, but I can't remember the name for it.
Well, stuff gets scrambled in my head too, but
there's too much information. But yeah, so each of, you know, you can't separate it. That's who Philip is, that's who Giovanni is. So their needs are very different. I don't even think that mental illness necessarily is always a bad thing. You know, sometimes anxieties also can lead you down certain paths, you know. So my eldest son who has anxiety and autism and, you know, severe mental illness, that anxiety has sort of kept him at home, but also forced him to learn how to access education in a different way and think differently. And he questions everything. I've never seen anything. It's so extraordinary. So instead of thinking, oh, everything's wrong with me, I've sort of shifted it for him and gone, okay, so this is how you are, this is how you feel. I wonder why, you know, how much of this is in your head and how much of it is pressure to be normal. Who even thought of running our life in the way it's run? And so he's taught to sort of look at life in a very critical way. Instead of going, oh, I don't fit in, he sort of now goes, lots of people don't fit in. There's lots of ways that we could do things differently. If the world was more open to difference, then we could all reach our full potential in a way that makes us comfortable doing it. And, you know, that's a huge goal, you know, but if I can achieve that in my children's heads, just the fact that there's nothing wrong with them, that they are who they are, mental illness, autism and all, and that we just need to figure out how to make the most of their lives from that starting point, I think that's really useful, because it's not about cures and change. This is it. There's no cure for mental illness. You know, you can manage it. There's no cure for autism. You wouldn't want one. There's ways to manage, you know, some of the issues that kids with autism face. So I'm teaching my children how to live as exactly who they are today, with all of the diagnoses and all of the issues. And hopefully I teach them enough that, you know, when I'm no longer here and they're grown, they can, you know, they would have learned enough to do it themselves.
I love it, Jo. That's a hugely positive message for all the families at home. And I'm really glad that that's your takeaway, and the boys are doing really well with
It's the only way you can do it with mental illness. It's the only way. It has to be empowering. It has to be you and your child figuring it out together. I was talking to Philip about it the other day, and I said, because I was writing an article about the fact that he's better, and I'm always scared to say that Philip's better and not suicidal anymore, because I'd say it and then he'd get sick again, and it's terrifying. And I was talking to some of the families, and I said, you know, the health system is, you know, it's very patchy and there's not a lot of help out there. And then if you find the help, it's too expensive, or that person doesn't gel with your child, or, you know, it's the public system, so they leave and you, like, it's a mess. You and your child have to be the ones who manage it and navigate it. So your kid is on his worst day, mentally unwell, you are terrified. All you can do as the parent is jump into that hole with them, hold them, and then figure out how to climb out together. That's literally the way it is. There's one thing you can do for your mentally ill child, is just be there with them on their darkest day and figure it out together.
Well, you've done a fair bit of that over the years, Jo.
A lot of it, yeah.
So as much as it sounds like everybody's doing okay in your particular confined and bunker, have you all agreed as a group of you, what's the first thing you're going to do when COVID's over and we can all go out again?
I think my boys are not looking forward to me going, that's it, we're leaving the house today, think of something you want to do. You know, they've got, I'm divorced, so they have gotten to go between two households. So that to me has been, you know, a sort of a weird bonus of being divorced, that they're not always just in the house. We are going to go on a wonderful trip to Coles this afternoon for a bit of outdoor grocery shopping. But I think really the beach is where we want to go. You know, Bondi reopens next Tuesday. I'd love to just go for a drive there. Obviously, my kids have autism, so sand is an issue. But, you know, we can go for a drive, smell the ocean, listen to the waves, eat lunch on the grass, feed some of this. Oh, no, we can't actually. I think we've got to keep moving. Okay, so power walk on the spot, throw chips in the air for the seagulls, you know, straight back to
like active wear, and you're on your family.
We might even just stay in the car and do a beach drive-by. But yeah, something like that would be really great, because one of the things we did while we were stuck at home was wash the car. We were so excited to have time to do that. And I was trying to think of an activity the boys would want to do. So we went to the garage, washed the car. It's been sitting there clean for 2 weeks. We've got nowhere to go. So yeah, I think a drive to the beach would be something we'd all really love to do.
Well, I'm very glad to hear that everybody in your family sounds like they're doing very, very well, Jo. Your bunker.
Yeah, they're too well. They're doing too well at home, but my daughter's going mad. So yeah, okay. I'll be very excited to
for her later.
Yeah.
All right, Jo, thank you so much for joining us today to have a chat about how you guys are going, and good luck and best to the boys.
Yeah, you too. Thank you so much. And now thanks to Autism Awareness Australia for all of your support and work. Honestly, I don't know where I'd be without you guys.
All right. Thanks, love.
Bye.